This is Life Center Around the Table with your host, Paul Martini.
For those of you who don't know who are listening, we have Pastor John Leach and Pastor Brian Leach.
Leach brothers. Pester and Brian.
Pester Brian Leach. That's amazing. So they, for those of you who also don't know, maybe you've been only coming to Life Center for a short period of time, they are brothers from the same mother. And they love each other.
It's been a tough road.
It's more than Christian brotherhood here. It's a deeper thing.
He's my brother.
Or maybe a lighter thing.
I don't know.
He's
not heavy.
He's my brother.
which is amazing. Like, this is where I really want to pick your brain is, like, growing up and, like, how does this Leach chemistry happen, unfold? I mean, people have these questions they've never had a chance to really ask you, and sometimes they hear snippets from stage and things of that nature, but you guys are not, you have more siblings than just the two of you. And actually, the more I find out about the both of you, the more I'm like totally surprised. Like, a lot of people don't know John Leach is a twin,
an identical twin.
Sorry. So tell me the whole dynamic of the family.
Well, actually, start back when God said, wow, that is good. He said, I'm so much, I'm going to make two because they're amazing. Like, so there it was.
And are you the oldest twin or the youngest?
Because there couldn't be that much weirdness in one.
We actually 5 minutes younger. We're born very close, and we are identical. So a lot of people at church have seen him. So
yeah,
he's the serious. Wouldn't you say the serious side of it? He's quite serious.
Just so everybody knows, I'm not that twin. I'm just going to make that really loud and clear.
It's true.
And where do you fall in the family line? Are you the oldest? Are you the youngest?
I'm the number of grace. I'm five.
You're five.
Yes.
Five.
That's that perfect
number. But many people take him for an older, much older brother. They really do. So, you know,
wisdom,
but it's okay.
Because of the wisdom and
strength.
Yeah. The height.
Knowledge. Understanding.
So if you're five, how many kids did your parents have?
Six kids. Girls on the outside, four boys in the middle, 8 years separating, six kids.
You're all a little
some
sick.
We were all clumped together. It was pretty fun. We really had a lot of fun. So growing up, we did. And Christmas was crazy. And my gosh, remember all that stuff?
A lot of fun. Yep. Yeah.
So,
you know, what really surprised me too is usually like large families like that are kind of like Christian born, you know, their Christian traditions, all that stuff. But your family is a first generational Christian family. Not like this multi-generational.
The kids are first generation. My parents, I mean, I can't say my parents never reached out to God, but my mom's a Catholic, Irish Catholic out of Pittsburgh, and my dad was a Presbyterian, and she was the first one to marry outside the faith. She really was. I mean, outside the faith, like the Catholic faith. Like, it was a
outside
big,
outside the perfect
big deal.
Faith.
Yeah, it was a big deal. Of course, you know a little bit about this Catholic background. Yeah. So I think it was a big change for her whole family. So, although we never heard any big fuss from her brother.
Yeah, we just partied a lot. It was fun.
Yeah. Seriously.
And honestly, Irish. Like, you weren't even as beautiful and holy as you two guys are. You weren't the first ones to receive Christ. Actually, the first person in your family to get saved of the kids was who?
You can say something.
Our oldest.
Go ahead.
Our sister was the firstborn.
Tell
first
me the story.
To say, first, yeah, one to, first one to do everything. And then she's the first one to meet Jesus, too.
She was. We went to Cumberland Valley High School. It's huge, big high school, a lot of fun.
Which is a local high school in the Harrisburg area.
Yeah, it's huge. It's like 3,000, somewhere in that. But back then it was like 2,500. And she went off to college, was a big partier, really crazy, fun person and everything. But she was on the edge of the campus at IUP, Indiana University of Pennsylvania, and on a Friday night, and was drunk out of her mind and heard this little, on the edge of campus was this little white church, and they had lights on the basement, had a cement walk down into the basement. She sat on the steps and listened to this guy give his testimony, and he actually came out. What is it, Brent?
Detweiler.
Brent Down. No, not Brent Down. That was Bo Natinsky. Came out and actually told us the story a couple of years ago at one of our sister's weddings. He was there, and he told us the story of going out and talking to Judy and praying for her, getting her sober, praying for her being saved, praying for her getting filled with the Spirit. And she never turned back. She was a serious evangelist.
She evangelized your family?
She did.
Is that right?
Yeah.
She came home really glowing. We could see the like her whole face had changed. It was absolutely amazing. Completely changed.
We did a good job of ignoring it and laughing at her scorn. That was pretty fun. I mean, she got her Bible out and told us all to get Jesus. And we just, like, it was hilarity then. It was is.
But you couldn't deny she really had the love of God. Oh my gosh, she was like, did. Wow, what happened to you? You're so happy and nice and kind, you know.
Like, really?
The for love serious, of God in real wow. lives.
How long did it take for the second person to come to Christ, and who was that in the family dynamic?
A year later, I think my brother, we went on, she went his first year in college, then we graduated, we were a year behind. He went to Carnegie Mellon and got saved there.
Was that your twin?
That was my twin, yeah.
What's his
yeah.
name?
Jamie.
Jamie.
Got saved, yeah. So he got saved totally, and that still didn't go, we still laughed and scorned and harassed him, but in the middle of it, he got his, a guy down the hall was a junior at the time, 2 years older than he was, and he witnessed him during lifting and working out, because Jamie was a crazy workout person. I mean, he was like 130 pounds, could bench 250. He was wow. crazy in shape. So anyway, during lifting, he evangelized Mike Steidel, who ended up being married my sister. But that was another miraculous thing, because Mike was one of those big Viking kind of guys, 220 pounds. And his life was go to, New England, up on the beach up there, and he would work at IHOP all night from midnight till 7.
Cape then, Cod, is that?
Yeah, Cape Cod, yeah. And get a case of beer and go drink all day on the beach and chase women. And so that's the kind of person my brother was witnessing to. And then this just bugged him. This just cut to his heart. So wow. one day he shows up at the gym. Is this true? If I get this right. And he tells Jamie, I do what you said. And he goes, what do you mean? Oh, I asked Jesus in my heart. So I guess lying on his bed in his dorm room, he asked the Lord into his heart, and Mike got totally transformed. He really wow. changed. So then Jamie ended up discipling him. Like he knew a lot. He was like months ahead. But they really worked themselves into following the Lord with all their heart. So
Wow.
But it was really funny guy. He's like, you know, because I remember telling Jamie, you gotta give up women. Like, what? like okay. Gotta quit drinking. What? So I was like, but he did. And I have to tell you, I got saved watching Mike get saved.
Come on.
My future brother-in-law get saved. I watched him give up his whole life and actually become better, like become this wonderful human being. And you can see a transformation. Even though you didn't know the person passed, you could see this person working through their life and change. So I ended up getting saved as a result of watching Mike.
Were you after Jamie then?
I was a couple years later.
Yeah.
In 78. I went up to visit my sister at IUP, and I got saved in one of those. What was the guy's name? It used to come through and speak to and preach on the campuses. It became a national ministry. What was it?
Chi Alpha.
Who was the guy? Maranatha Ministries was the one guy.
Mitch Smith.
But the other guy. Who was the other guy? Bob Weiner.
Oh, okay.
Bob Weiner, even before Maranatha, he would come through the colleges and speak. He was young. And outside the building, and then they'd use whatever building they could. They were in this little church off of campus. And I remember everybody packing into the place, doing worship, and Bob Weiner spoke. And then if you want to meet Jesus, talk to somebody in the back. And so I got saved back then.
Did you feel like a conviction going on? Or obviously this was a buildup, right? Like you're seeing your sister get saved, your brother get saved.
And then you made an appointment to get saved.
Yeah, I did. Besides two things.
Which is your personality, right?
What?
I do. Actually, I don't know if it was, conviction's one way, but I think actually the love of God was walking right into my fraternity room in my college life and ruining my perfect life, because I had this perfect life that I was going on to be a senator, law school senator, and then wow. president of the United States. So, but that didn't work out, totally that way, but I'm happier. So.
You've upgraded, man.
I've upgraded, seriously. So anyway, he walked in our room. So I don't know if it's conviction. It was more like this love and warmth of God. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you're making me crazy. You're ruining my good life. But he didn't. He made it even better. So
yeah.
So my salvation wasn't like I wasn't a wreck or the end of the road or, you know, I was like everything I was doing was wonderful and my life was coming together perfectly. But then there was a sense of real emptiness in it. So even though it was all going perfect, it was like, this isn't really what I want. God right. kept showing me that. It was pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Oh, it was really cool.
And I'm glad we're saving one of the last salvation stories. Brian, your story is incredible. And I know a bunch of people have heard it. But honestly, when I heard it the first time, I think it was almost maybe 8 months ago, 7 months ago. Yeah. It was the first time I heard it. Blew my mind. And it's just really profound. Can you share where you were? Tell me the dynamic, the context of you're seeing all your sister and your brothers get saved.
Our siblings got saved. There was one other brother and I. We thought that everybody had lost their mind. We really did. We made fun of everybody.
Is this the 70s going to
the We literally, 70s, I mean.
Like hard rock. Everything was like, eh, the deal. Right. You know,
we really mocked you guys. We made fun of. Judy, we knew was authentic. The rest we really weren't sure about. We'd like, yeah, they just trying to do it because everybody else is doing this. And we would literally do drugs and talk to you guys. Tell us about how you talked to Jesus. That's the true story. I remember.
Yeah, but
like,
still we'd answer you.
And they would answer us, be totally authentic and tell them how much God loves us. And we just thought, like, really? Do you need a crutch? You can't handle life? Like, is it too much pressure? And anyhow, so yeah, down the road another few years.
If you're like Mr. GQ, you could do all this stuff and be crazy and still pull off like you're totally together. Like,
you
did have that GQ thing. Yeah, mm-hmm. He was always together, but he was wild.
So,
person.
I was out partying one night and full of a lot of alcohol and drugs and just drove right into a bridge. And the bridge just moved. I don't understand. It just jumped out in front of my car. And there I was.
Yes, cement bridge.
That's what you told your dad, right? Yeah. Just, but so you were going quite fast.
Yeah,
like
they think somewhere 80 some miles an hour is what they guesstimate. But it was down at the bottom of a hill. It was a slight turn, very slight turn. I just drove straight into the concrete.
It's just a country road too. I remember going
country road out in the middle of nowhere, and
that's fast.
And so yeah, I thought it was perfect because we grew up in the automobile business. We all could drive since we were like 10 or 12, you know.
Sure.
So I literally thought someone hit me. Woke up with barely could see out of one eye with tubes everywhere. Mm-hmm. And my father lovingly got down in my ear and screamed at me, "You drove into a bridge," and there was much alcohol is enough for two or three people. And I thought, uh-oh.
Our dad was a truth teller.
Pretty intense.
Well, you also, I mean, they put a sheet over you.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
You know, so talk about
that. Yeah, a paramedic found me. I passed the guy, and I remember passing the car, and I thought it was it looked like it had municipal plates, but they were just plates from Maryland, so they're just, you know.
They're like, oh, that's not a cop.
Exactly. So this guy found me as a paramedic, found me at about 2:30 in the morning, and they did. They put the sheet over me and said couldn't find a pulse, and got a mile from the hospital. My arm started moving. When they called my house, my sister came home that weekend, and she heard the phone ring, and God spoke to her and said, "Stand against death, your brother. You know, the enemy's come to steal your brother's life. As you stand and pray, he will live." Just as clear as day.
Yeah.
Wow. So she was calm, said he'll be fine. And my parents came a little bit unglued. And
this is 79, wasn't it?
80.
80. It was just
February
80.
Of 80.
February.
Yeah,
that's right. So I remember she came home and she really felt God speak.
But she immediately alerted people in Pittsburgh and in IUP and Philly, all these college campuses to pray. Campus ministry. So we literally had hundreds of students praying within minutes of this accident. That's crazy.
So you basically were dead.
Yeah.
You're brought back to life.
And then wake up in a hospital room.
You wake up in a hospital.
I have no idea what happened.
Wow.
So.
And then spent the next
few months in traction in a hospital room. After I came to, after I was in there a few months, I got a letter from my sister and shared this whole story. And I remember just breaking down, just crying for hours on this bed, or like 3 days on my hospital bed, because I was in traction, so I couldn't even get out of bed. It was really crazy.
But you got to tell them how you have to see it in one of one. I saw the car. He hit a bridge abutment that was probably, what, a 20-foot bridge, but it wasn't a big bridge. But when he hit it, hit at the left corner of the car. He tore the car open like a can opener and rolled it three times. He was thrown out of the vehicle.
That's
probably
right.
Saved your life, because it would have been squished like a bug in it, because there wasn't anything left of the vehicle.
Wow.
They swept it up in a flat car and just dropped a flatbed. And drive it back. But
yeah, I mean, when you're doing 70 miles over the speed, if you do 70 miles or higher, even with a seatbelt on, it's a 50-50 chance you're going to live with the seatbelt on.
Wow.
Tore that car.
The pounds of pressure is just crazy when you're up at that speed. And they say even if you're about to get into an accident, like a head-on, try to get below 40 as fast as you can, because your chances of survival go up a lot higher.
Never knew that.
When we hit the bridge,
he hit it.
I mean, probably stopped to zero then.
Well, the car was just demolished, right? So, you're in traction.
So I was in traction on
the what'd you break? Tell them what you broke.
Oh, I broke pretty much all the bones on the left side of my body.
She was all right.
I took out my spleen. Yeah, I was all
right.
Wow. Exactly. So it was nuts. But I do remember having these encounters in the hospital room on this bed. I felt like Jesus would sit on the bed at these times, and I would just have these encounters where I didn't even speak, and I just weep and weep. So
wow.
Totally crazy. So it was nuts for a few months in the hospital. And then I got out, and I didn't get discipled, didn't get involved in a church, and it took me a couple years to start changing and growing.
We went in to see him in the hospital, and first sets of people I went in with, we had two people pass out just by looking at him. So it was pretty tough.
Yeah. Wow, so it must have been a really, really
ugly.
Bad, tragic scene.
Yeah.
And then
broke your pelvis. How do you break your pelvis?
Yeah. So how long were you recovering? Like, of course,
it was a few months, and then it was a good, not till the next fall, they took more metal out of my elbow. So it was a good, I'd say 9 months till I got back to.
Were you in like a full body cast?
No,
like I had a friend who broke a femur, and
I broke my femur in three spots.
And he, yeah, so he had like a from his
like. Well, they just kept me in bed, so they kept a pin through my leg, and my leg was elevated with weights at the end of it. Wow. And I was that for about a month. I was in there, and then they took me back in for like a 7-hour operation and made an elbow because the elbow was just crushed in like four places. So that was pretty crazy. So I switched from doing drugs, and they started giving me these shots of Demerol every few hours.
I remember.
So my whole right side was completely black and blue, my legs, my arms from shooting shots of Demerol. So I literally became addicted to Demerol within a month because they were just trying to keep me pain-free. And it was pretty crazy.
Do you beep when you go through the airport? No, like don't. Scream? Like you don't have? Do you still have metal in your body?
I do have little tiny little pieces, but there's real. It doesn't make noise.
And what's crazy to me is you're like super athletic.
Yeah.
You know, so like this hasn't impeded your ability to. Not at all. And I find that about every leech I've met, they all have like an athletic ability, even if they don't look like they have athletic ability.
Thank you.
They do run,
John,
and they do move,
John.
And I'm not saying that, no. But I'm just saying there's some sort of gene you guys have.
I move,
like
and
if
live
I
and have your bean, Duncan.
Hey, my lineage is pub and porridge. That's my lineage. Uh-huh. So like Austrian mountain climber. I'm like pub porridge. That's kind of how it goes, you know.
So. We had a few hobbits in our family.
Yeah. You did get the Kennedy side. You did on your side. So,
well, I mean, it's striking to me. I just think you guys are just made of good stock, you know. So nice. So even more so, it's, you know, you can kind of see God's hand weaving through your family.
Absolutely.
And
it
just
powerful. It's Judy wrote your letter. You did say
that's
that.
It. Yeah.
Yeah, you wrote your letter.
Totally crazy. Explained it. Got wrecked from that. You're so
hanging in the hospital. Yeah, I remember that. You got changed. It's powerful.
And then had that like work out.
It was about time, but it was powerful. It was
Yeah. And you said, God, you know, he even goes after the one.
No, exactly.
He goes after that one.
That weakest link.
Amazing. Yep.
You do love him, right, John? I'm just kidding. I'm just messing. It's so
there's
fun.
There's not too many Brians in the whole world.
I know.
My God, he's so intense.
Amazing.
And so driven, which is really great.
Yeah. I'm super impressed just spending time with you, Brian, and just the way you carry yourself. You know, how you care, you know, for everything, and just you invest a lot of who you are into everything you do. Yeah. So I just definitely see that. And a lot of people see that about you, but a lot of people don't get to see behind the scenes. You know, they see Sundays or Wednesdays and all that stuff. And one of the best things that I just enjoyed being at Life Center is that, you know, when you interact with the staff off stage, they're the same character, the same personalities. They're still beautiful, amazing people. So that's like
that's
a super blessing for me because like relieves the tension because there are ministries and people and, you know, we're not going to name anybody, but, you know, that and it's not Global Awakening because I used to work for them. They're amazing too. But, you know, that they you hear about these ministries that are, you know, are only one way on stage,
right,
but off
right.
the stage are not that way. And so it's not the case at Life Center. It's just beautiful here.
Cool.
So
Brian's always been, you've been driven. You always, even when we were kids.
Yeah, I think we're all kind of driven.
Playing, but you definitely have a driven sense. Like you assess things, see things. Even when you work with Mark and you guys were lifeguards at the pool just everything, you're always assessing, like how can we improve and stuff like that. So I think when God grabbed your life, it really changed. It even accelerated it more.
Yeah.
I do think so.
Did you find that was just a natural thing for you? Or do you find that, you know, something happened in your life that made you that way?
I'm not sure. Yeah. I don't know. I think we're all driven as leeches. We've all kind of been intense. That
could be.
Trying to make it the best.
I don't know a lazy
leech.
This
is a good thing or a bad
thing.
I haven't met
a lazy leech. Maybe
admit,
you know one.
I got to admit, when David got married to Johanna, she did say to him, Dave, you don't have to confront about everything. It's not always good to confront everything. I'm like, that was a whole new thought to me.
That's a good thought.
I was
wow. We don't?
Maybe we don't. What do you mean we don't?
What are you talking about?
Go ahead.
How did you guys get involved in church? All right, so I heard about, you know, God touching your life in a radical way, but how did it come to now Word Fellowship, essentially, which became Life Center?
Yeah.
Was that you, Brian? Did you bring us there?
I was listening. I came home a couple summers and worked with John in our family business. And the guy that had started the church had a radio program on. So as soon as I started listening, I'm like, where is this guy?
Yeah.
And he's like, he's an Harrisman. I'm driving there tomorrow. I want to go meet this because it was a good church. you know, and the guy was really with it. And I just thought, man, it's crazy not to go see and
experience. Dave Lanza's Word of Grace up on Progress Avenue now, but Dave and Bruce Smith, Dave Lanza, they were hilarious. They do the word kind of thing. They had a half-hour broadcast. And
radio
they were
show.
Hilarious. They took God seriously, but didn't take themselves seriously. And back then, the Word of Faith movement was just cruising. They were Word of Faith, but they weren't, like, so serious. They were much more levity and brevity and fun and just sharing about how God had changed their life and how fun it is, you know, and that kind of captured us. So I think you went and visited the church.
I did, yeah.
At a church
on 13th Street.
Yeah.
And I came back. I think that was that summer that I went, I had graduated Penn State and then went to the church a little bit and you guys came over and visited.
Right.
And I went back to Penn State as a, worked with the church up there that I was a part of a church there as a youth pastor for about like 3 years.
Yep.
And then came back, but guys came and visited and said, we're staying.
So they did.
Came but you guys were youth 85. Leaders at a church in Carlisle at that
we
time.
We were, with a little church in Carlisle that was going through. But it had gone through, like a lot of independent churches back then, which to answer your question, originally we all came out of our main line denominations. Mm-hmm. We tried to go back. They kind of couldn't fit us in because, I mean, we were fresh saved. But we also wanted to bring all the life, like wanted to bring music and technology. And they couldn't kind of fit that in for us. They were very patient, but it just wasn't a fit. So back then, you're talking about the early 80s, a lot of people started, the whole charismatic movement kind of jumped in and people started meeting in homes and a lot of us got saved at prayer meetings rather than at an official church service. So we kind of reconstructed the church according to that relational background and that's why kind of they got birthed. That's how Word Fellowship was originally birthed in 78. Pastor was a Word of Faith, first graduating class out of Rhema Bible College. So they came back and just started in his living room. So the church took on a whole different dynamic. I'm not saying that God's in every place.
Yeah, sure, sure.
But for us, it was a whole new fresh deal. And so when we joined, it was still kind of still forming. It had been in going, we came in 85, so it had been like 7 years. But they were just, churches like this were blossoming everywhere.
Yeah, it was like a fresh wind of God, yeah, a fresh, really you know, exactly. Movement that you felt God
real.
On. And so you felt his presence and you decided to stay.
That's
and come.
The presence
yeah.
of God was amazing.
Oh my gosh.
You know, so... And then you jumped in as youth leaders, or you guys started volunteering.
Yeah, so I was
right
going to ask if were you both youth leaders at one point?
Yeah, you were in Harrisburg, and I was in Penn State.
Okay. I was better though, much better, more talent. I'm just
kidding. You guys aren't competitive at all. Did your parents like? Did your father make you competitive? Like,
no.
Did he have you guys compete for things? Did he raise you that way?
Whoever
it was like, which one's better?
Whoever wrestled got the got the cereal
the
in the morning.
I mean, if you have
he
six
didn't
kids,
get any porridge.
No, we were just naturally driven. My dad was naturally driven, and so were we.
Yeah, it's so, awesome. Good. But now you're driven for the kingdom, which makes you like these amazing tools for God and God's tool belt. So, you guys became youth pastors here at Word.
I was in State College at a church up there, and for a couple of years, and then I came back after 2.5-3 years and thought I did my penance. I thought, okay, God, I did what I need to do. Now I can go get a real job.
But that was a really,
I really seriously
that
thought
was a great.
It was great. It was a place of discipleship for a couple of years.
Gosh, just tell them a little bit of stuff like you just.
It was a small, few hundred member church outside of State College, and it was just a husband and wife team that ran the church, and I was the first person they brought on, you know, to like do everything that they didn't want to do, run the youth, you know, run the ushers, run the sound, do it all.
Really
it was great. I loved it, but I literally just spent hours a day just in prayer and just reading the Bible day and night because I didn't grow up in church. I didn't know the word. I didn't have any clue. And they had
felt
a Bible,
like you had to play catch up.
Yeah, I did. And they had a Bible school they offered. It was one of the satellite Bible courses that were back in the mid 80s were a big deal. So I just took every class offered them. Some really great. And this is like Marilyn Hickey was some of the first classes she taught.
No way.
Oh my gosh. Brilliant.
That's cool.
This is 84,
Charles
85,
Neiman.
86. Charles Neiman is at El Paso, Texas, has a huge church there. Just world class stuff. Like it was absolutely amazing. So,
it was a great kind of first branch at like satellite churches doing classes. I remember you doing it. I remember you were there like 5:30 every day of your life. Like
to open the, we had a school, so people came in and watched everything satellite on TV and these large screens. This is back when no one had, you know, we had projectors and no one really had projectors and big screens. And like we set it up as a classroom. It was totally amazing. So, but I took class by Kenneth Copeland's mom, taught a class. Like,
no
stuff.
Way.
It was brilliant.
It was
like
real
stuff deep. But it was like we took Demonology 1, 2, and 3 by Lester Summerall, like old school people, you know. And I just consumed a day and night. So there was a season that I felt like that was after about 2.5-3 years. I felt like the Lord said to go back to Harrisburg. Yeah. So I came back to Harrisburg thinking, okay, I'll go get a real job in the field I graduated, which was healthcare. I'll get into that, you know, and every door was closed and ended up just volunteering, helping at the church. And 32 years later, I'm still just helping at the church.
it was an amazing season because I remember that season. Larry Lee led prayer across the country. And so everybody's getting up at like 5 o'clock. Not everybody, but certain groups were getting up and then making a discipline. I remember your crew got up. Oh. Gosh, you just, it was every day for two, 3 years, you know.
It's pretty intense.
We were doing it at the church, praying all the time. So it's just one of those seasons that kind of just built your foundations. It really was, between the word and prayer. Really made a difference, so. Yeah, you came back and you jumped in and started helping. Then you started helping in the video, the whole, we went on television. And back then, everybody's going on television and taking airtime and learning how to do it. So you learned how to do it. You learned how to do the whole thing, I remember.
Yeah.
Yeah, the studio was put together. The whole television studio was about 50 or 60% put together. And the guy that was putting it together left and said, okay, you put it together. And I have a degree in administration. I was like, I have no idea. So I started getting these guys that moonlighted from different television stations local and said, hey, tell me how to finish and put it together. We had a timeline. We had already contracted with the local TV station to go on there.
JCB.
Wow.
So
that's
said,
a lot
okay.
of pressure.
So I just went and figured it all out, started reading books, talking to producers and production guys and engineers, and we figured it all out and started going on TV. You know, we had about 4 different cameras we used, and it was pretty powerful. But at the same time, my heart was still for youth because I was working with teenagers and state colleges. That this is all I want to do is help kids not do the same thing I did. You know? And John and Patty were leading the youth ministry at that time. So it was 87.
And he jumped in, took over like he does everything.
Well, he does a great job, too.
And it was better. It was improved when Brian took it.
Some of the cool stories you were telling me before, Brian, was like about creation. Like you take everyone out to creation.
That was crazy. And we did that, a lot of those together. We did them almost
we
all
We did that
in
22
together.
Years. Yeah. We did creation. Wow. That's a whole other podcast.
Yeah.
Hilarious.
Yeah, we can talk about that, too.
That's crazy. So.
That's amazing. So, what you know, one of the themes that like I've noticed about All the Leeches, which is, you know, popular with most people is family. Family seems to be a big thing that you guys are all about. And even like the way you guys do life together, it's not just individually, you know, like vacationing, you know, it's like you guys go to the Carolinas sometimes and,
sometimes.
You know, and Outer Banks and, you know, so, and it's not just like, you know, you congregate your families, right? And so, So is that like something that came down through your parents, or is that something you guys really had to work at? That
I think, you know, strong sense of family, and then we had a family business. So, I mean, it was like work and play and life just happened all together, and it was authentic. I mean, you couldn't be one way at work and one not way at home. It all kind of, it really did blend together. We just lived and worked together all the time. I mean, in the family business, it wasn't about the pay. It was about being successful what you did. And successful meaning like you kept your value system, you knew who you were, you knew how to handle yourself, you knew how to represent the family business. I mean, it was kind of washed into our whole lives, don't you think, Donnie?
Absolutely.
Our dad really drilled that into us. He was a leader. He did very well in his day in school. Then he went into the automobile business in the late 40s and 50s, and it was the madman day. So he really, it was a call for him more than just a job. It was a calling, and then it was leading. And so he took that back to his family business. I mean, it was a modest business, but it was really it was run by a value system.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we learned how to initiate, run things, do things, act like owners and stewards rather than hirelings. So it wasn't what we could get away with, it's what we could accomplish that was much more important, you know, to us. Even in the smallest of ways, it had to be authentically cleared. It's just something our dad put in our lives, don't you think so?
Absolutely. And the family is so mixed in it. I think that's where we're so used to.
Yeah.
So when we both got involved in ministry, we just jumped in everything.
Just took all the value system right into it. And it's like, so the family business was even more, I mean, if it could be more, it was more, you had to be authentic all the way. So you worked and played. This is your life. You know, this is how we do things. This is what we do. And more of that, how can we get more of you into us and what we unlearn and we repent from and move to. And like, God, that was stupid. We were being that way. Let's change. Let's get better. We just kind of lived openly like that.
Did your parents see? You know, obviously, you talked about your brothers and sisters receiving Jesus. Did your father and mother end up going that route? Did they see? Did they see what you guys went through and said, "Man, I gotta do the same thing"? Or did they say, "No, it's not for me"?
A year after my accident, our mom passed. So it was pretty intense. When you looked back, we looked at the picture and you could really see how God was coming into our lives. Now the enemy came in at the same time, or
he
almost
did.
almost simultaneously to try to kill everybody, like just take my sister out, me out, my mom out. It was crazy.
Wow.
So you could see that. At the same time, you really could see it after our mother passed. Our dad really did. He came to the Lord in a very powerful way.
Yeah. Yeah, we suffered some of those things that came against us because our mom passed, and right before that, Mike Stidell, who had become our brother-in-law at that point, his mom passed from cancer. Wow. So it was almost like this onslaught that kind of came against our family. But instead of dividing us, it kind of pulled us even tighter together. We found a way. I mean, the hurts were real. It hurt, you know, because losing her was difficult. But everybody kind of stepped up and stepped closer, which was a good thing, and held onto our faith even more. And we did grow. So it was very helpful that God was there speaking to us because we turned to him. It was totally real to us, you know. So how do we keep this going? So you were asking about family, though, how that
Yeah, so I was just wondering how, you know, first of all, you know, being in ministry, going to church, connecting with other friends of mine, you really see how there's a lot of basic things that you learn in healthy families that are so absent. And you don't realize, man, what I have is actually a treasure. And we just took it for granted. We thought, oh, every family's like this. Yeah. Like, I'll see your family. I'm like, man, I wish I was like your son. Or, you know what I mean? Like, at some points, because I'm like, man, what my father lacked and I see you carried. And and so I just kind of want to know, like, how did that make you guys up? And so I was like, you know, with family, I see a lot of these essential things already in your lives, in your kids' lives, and of course your wives have a lot to do with that too, which we'll talk to later on another podcast. But I just think really it translates to the church family in a lot of ways, because you really you carry what you have in what you grew up in, maybe, or what maybe God's placed in your life, and you really start to influence others that you communicate with, and that's evident.
You're heading to our parents, and I did want to say, Brian, that's right, my mom passed, but
sorry.
I remember when we got saved, it was like odd for our parents. Like, instead of rejoicing, they thought we were freaks, you know.
Yeah, there was that part.
And it took them a while to kind of see the fruit of it, to say that my mom probably had turned her life over as much as she could. Her parents had died before she met my dad, and so she had, in her own quiet way, had turned her life over to the Lord. She's a real, real Catholic, real serious about it. So then she met my dad, which was a jump off the high dive, but he was full of life and fun. But I think dad's salvation took a while for him, and I remember one of his first heart situations. He had a heart bypass, and we were working to watch over him during that time after my mom had passed. And I remember going in to talk to him about, okay, I got to go talk to dad about Jesus, you know. And I walked in and I started a conversation. And he just stopped me and said, oh, I know all about this. I went, well, what? How do you know about? Oh, Brian. Brian told me everything, chapter and verse. I remember him quoting me back the scriptures, everything. Like, oh, Brian told me everything. And I had, like, never talked to my dad about Jesus, just kind of lived it. But Brian was so good about, you just were so good about evangelizing. You had this truth thing that he's got to know the truth. I remember being beside his bedside before he went into the surgery for bypass, and he said, I know it all. Here it is. I'm like, what the heck? Like, who told you?
I was surprised. I was surprised he heard it all.
He heard it, man. Yeah. Quoted it back. So I needed to think about it. So that was pretty powerful. So we, in a sense, we believe that we helped bring our parents to, well, at least our father to faith. You know, dad, as you're up there, you can make agree about that. But it happened. So you really told them about it. Then we lived it in front of them.
And I think all the children, you know.
Yeah, I agree.
Living it in front of them was a big testimony.
Yeah.
Brian, do you find that you're more of an evangelist, you know, at heart?
I don't know.
Would you find that that's something that you did at least for a long time, is just evangelize?
So. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
You know, I just think because there was how I what got saved is so dramatic. I thought, okay, I want to, you know, to rescue as many teenagers as we can, you know, young people in general. But with family, it was a big deal because I thought, God, you got to get this. We all got it. You know, God's changed our lives. We can't let you out here, you know.
You have this truth thing, though. You got to, like, it's important to you. You got to speak the truth. Like, you've got to lay it out there. You know, I'm a little different, more internal. You're definitely external. Like, even in every situation, even here where we're working together, it's like, you got to get the truth out on the table. What is the truth? You know, and everybody see it. And you carry that. You're driven about that. You really carry it in your life.
Yeah. So when it comes to...
Except for your opinions of me, which are quite... Right. You know, so.
I mean, I think... I think
they're just wrong.
I think Brian talks very highly of you, John.
There you go.
Thanks, you know, and there's other, you know, he definitely has your back. He's your brother.
Definitely.
We can do family counseling later.
All right.
with this whole thing. But yeah, Brian, I mean, you also have this thing of excellence. I think, John, you carry that too. I think it translates to how we do life in church. I know that's one of our, you know, our core principles. And I thought it'd be cool to, if you guys could also speak into some of those things. Like one of the taglines that I heard when I first came to Life Center over and over again was from John, and it would be repeated. It's like, you know, hey, we're here to experience the love of God and give it away. What's the background for all that? Where'd that come from? When did that start?
Yeah, that's a good question.
You know, I think
we brought it. Charles was a big proponent of that.
Sure.
I think he articulated that pretty clearly, you know.
I think when we first came here, we saw, you know, we were pretty much a tight group, and then we came to this building, and then it grew, and then we had to, you know, in earnest, we wanted to say, okay, if we're going to spread out and delegate authority, we need to make sure our value system, what it is. So we did some drilling down in, okay, what is important to us? It was an exercise that we all did. I remember.
And when you say we, you're talking about Charles and Anne,
yeah,
you and Patty and Marcy and Brian.
And right? And more. And the core staff. Okay. We sat, I think it was sat all of us. I don't know if you guys remember, we sat all at a time, and we took some weeks to go through, like, you know, a day or two a week to go through. Okay, let's reevaluate and let's pull out our value system. Let's pull out what's really important to us. And we worked through it. We really did. And we came up with experience the love of God and give it away, because so many of us had encountered God, and that was the transitional point right there. Like, you could read about him, you could know about him, but until you experienced it and encountered God and it changed you, or even if it haunted you in a good way, like he haunted you, that's what transformed your life. And I still think that's what exists till today. We're looking for, where does everybody mark their life? It's not the perfect teaching or that, it's the encounter point. If that was by the word or in worship or in fellowship, the encounter, the experience is what resets your life. You know what I mean? Many people may be doing that right now, you know, like a chance to reevaluate. So,
and it's the love of God. It's more than anything
else.
It is the love that we realize changed every one of our lives.
That's true.
And still does. So it's like,
yeah, it does.
The excellence factor, I think that was part of, I think, all of us together. I know our family, personally, our Leach family, our parents are pretty driven. Whatever you do, do it with all your heart. Mm-hmm. Do it with excellence, you know. Yeah. Whatever job you had, be the best at it, whatever that was, you know. So we had that. It was a huge part of who we are.
Yeah.
And, of course, Charles and Anne the same way. If we're going to do this, let's do it really well, you know. Let's be authentic.
Yeah.
So. Charles and Anne have a genuine conscience about being Christians. It's not a system to them or an empire. It's like a personal devotion to them. And, I mean, you can't beat that being so principled, because from those decisions, even if you make the wrong ones, you're going to come back to the right ones. Not that they make wrongs, but it's just, look, we have to follow our conscience no matter what, you know, and they're very honest about that with themselves. And we've kind of all caught that, you know.
Yeah, I totally, I mean, it's definitely something that comes through for Charles and Anne as well. And and it seems that you guys are so united in all the core values that you do carry and the culture that you kind of really host here. And it transcends everything. And I'm just so, you know, like, it might even be like a little piece of paper on the ground. You know, I'll see that John will pick it up. And I didn't notice the paper. It's like, you know, of course, if I saw it, I would pick it up. But John notices those things. I know, Brian, you notice things like that. Yeah. And I know that, you know, like, the majority of your name is the word bleach. And you guys love cleaning. And it, like, it blew. It was like a revelatory thing one day. I saw someone walking
Ryan
with
Leach.
A bottle of bleach.
Really, yeah.
And I thought, oh my gosh, they love cleaning. There's some connection here. I'm just kidding. But and that's only because I know David. David, David's a good friend of mine, your son, John, and he's a worship pastor here at Life Center. Amazing guy. Loves to clean, or is a clean person. And
Lives to clean.
Like, I thought I was clean, but nope. Yeah. No, I met David, and then I found out I wasn't clean.
There you go.
David's clean.
Seriously.
So, well, we want to wrap up here in a little bit, but I just wanted to, you know, kind of circle back to a few different things, and just wanted to ask a couple key things for, I'm just curious, I think they're fun questions. Who was your favorite musician, Brian, growing up?
I don't know. It's so many, because I had older siblings, so I listened to all the stuff from the late mm-hmm. 60s all the way through the punk stage to the horrible 80s.
Wasn't Leonard Skinner
Striper? Was Striper?
Striper? We listen to a lot of Led Zeppelin.
Led Zeppelin, okay. Yeah, all right.
To, you know, had to get the lead out.
Yeah, yeah.
The lead
and
out.
And then when you got saved, did you go straight Keith Green?
Oh, like, was a hard trip. I'm glad you said that. You must have heard me talk about this before.
I just know that time
frame. Yeah, because I got saved and they gave me Amy Grant, which is wonderful. It just was such a different genre than I was used to.
that's a hard transition for anyone back in the 80s, from Christian, from secular to Christian music.
And these other bands, I shouldn't mention their names. It was just it was definitely a transitional tragedy for me.
His head was down a lot.
I just thought, wow, God.
He moved into prayer.
Like, there has to be better worship music.
I can still see his head like, oh, Jesus.
I mean, nowadays, worship music is
amazing.
But there was definitely growing pains. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I love some Keith Green.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yep.
But
Amy Grant, wonderful. It just was different.
Right.
Wonderful.
And I definitely...
Personally, I like them. He didn't like House of the Other Side.
It's because you like disco when disco is
good. Oh, yeah. Earth, Wind, and Fire. Come on, Earth, Wind, and Fire.
I mean, you like
cool.
Silk shirts and high-waisted knit pants. Like, who wears that?
High-waisted knit pants. I was get some good dad jeans going.
I was so ashamed. My older brother's like, really? You wear that in public?
It was a different. It was like a different generation between us.
Right.
Just in that transition, you were like Russ Taff and
all
that. Yeah.
Imperials, what's the guy chains up in the sky? What's a guy?
Mylon Lefebvre.
Mylon was different.
Come crack the sky for me.
Yeah. Mylon was different. Yeah.
Yeah. All those.
Well, we saw that whole era come in the late 80s and into the 90s. Worship just took over the country. It was great. But before that, it was a challenge. The old days were fun too, though. You know, Phil Keaggy and all that crew. Keith Green, they were amazing.
Yeah, Phil Keaggy came to Messiah College.
Sad shaving.
Wow.
My sister was friends with him. They had just had him in IUP, they invited the whole band to their apartment.
For spaghetti dinner.
And so when he came to Messiah, she's like, you're all got to go. And so we all went out and did drugs and we went with her to the concert. I'm like, wow, this guy's playing Bach on the guitar. How do you do that? I was mesmerized.
He's like one of the best guitar players ever.
He was. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
We met him after the concert. I'm like, wow, you're cool. And he had that same Jesus glow. I'm like, wow, you're one of these Jesus people, right?
You could see it on him.
Oh,
hey.
Yeah.
I think I went to the concert with you.
I think you're right.
Brian, what kind of haircut did you rock? Were you rocking the, you know, party
the
in the back,
line,
business
I had
the in
the
front?
Big lines, man. You know, big lines.
Big lines.
The feathered front. Back. That was so cool.
You blow dried your hair.
Back then.
Yeah.
Back then when?
Kind of looked like yours. Oh, no. Yours is updated. I'm sorry.
Bro, wait. So wait. So,
I'll let it go.
I'm like a half second behind you, Brian. You're so quick. So like this is like on a side note about hair, and I have both my.
Well, this is about hair. Brian doesn't know anything.
I'm totally bald too. That's
Me
why
too.
I'm wearing this cap.
Yeah,
but the thing is like my mother's father had a full head of hair till he was 89. My father had a full head of hair in his 70s when he passed.
It's
you know,
personal.
There's no, it only happened, like, I can only find baldness in, like, uncles.
Yeah.
And now it got to me.
I think I'm the same way. Yeah.
Is that the same deal?
Anybody in the whole leech line, everybody's got big.
I think you're the first.
But I started doing.
Leech a trendsetter, Brian.
Brian, just to give you encouragement, I started doing, like, research and church history. And apparently, when you have a strong anointing on your life.
Really?
The hair follicles can't stand.
There we go.
So, you know, the monks and all that stuff, that's where that came
Something's
from.
Something's got to go because it's only a thin film up there between the both of you guys. It just the hair's got
to
go.
Well, you know, I just figured you're supposed to give your all to the Lord. So just
lay it all down.
People
don't realize the struggle we have. All right. Definitely there's benefits to being bald.
Seriously?
I haven't had a pay for a haircut in like 10 years.
Yeah. Good.
Walking in the sun. Like the first time I shaved my head and I walked in the sun, like totally got it toasted. Got to always wear a cap.
Yeah,
you know, when it's freezing out, like you people don't hear it. Hey, come on.
I'm sorry about that. Okay,
I'm telling a story. I'm going into a story.
This is getting personal.
But this is like a real thing.
Really?
People? Yeah.
Okay.
I'm just trying to see you don't. Trust me, people right now who are listening who are bald are feeling my pain right now. Okay.
Did you hear that?
You have no idea.
Did you hear? Listen for it. It's the Whambulance.
The Whambulance
is coming. Right.
And then I also relate to you, John, because I'm also vertically challenged. I'm not the tallest boy in the in the bunch.
Going to become an honorary member? You want to go there?
So,
but you probably don't have hair in
so
your
I have the worst
knuckles,
of everything.
Feet all
like the
I'm
hobbits,
Italian,
the
bro.
Hobbits,
like, I'm, like a, I'm like a bear oh. underneath here.
Right. You were the like Martini a, Corleone family. I remember meeting your family. So it's
oh, my gosh.
We do have some mob roots. There
oh
might be.
Gosh,
there
you
might
have
be. Just a
like
tad.
Christian mafia going to your church back. Oh, they're amazing. They are amazing.
They
guys.
Are. They're a bunch they're of awesome beautiful guys. Italians who love
they
Jesus.
Are. They are.
Don't and like, are unapologetically, you know, from the Northeast.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, you don't want to be like down an alley, you know, with them at all. Oh, you, or you don't want to owe them anything.
Up against the wall, get saved.
Bro, I'll tell you this much. If you owe them a favor, you know, it's like a favor is a thing. You
it's
know
a
what I mean?
Deal, yep.
It's a thing. Even the Christian, it's like, oh, you did me a favor. Okay. Or I owe you a favor. Yeah, it's like you owe him a move, at least. Right. You know, a U-Haul move, which is a big deal. So anyway, guys, it's been so incredible having
it's
you on and
you,
just love getting to
more,
know you guys
it's
more
incredible,
and more.
Not incredible, but more
it's,
incredible.
It's definitely incredible. We'll have fact checkers okay, looking okay. at all of this and probably following up on it. But just I love having you guys on here. We're definitely going to be having you again, and I'd love to hear your stories. And it's just an honor to have you guys. So we love you.
Thanks for having us.
And thanks so much for joining with us and our Life Center podcast. We're going to start calling this Around the Table.
All right.
Which is a great, great theme. So bless you guys if you're listening
next time,
to this.
Snacks, maybe?
Yeah, we can have snacks. Like we can. I don't know if I want to hear you crunching, but it's okay. Anyway, bless you guys. It's a thing he does. He's a snack man.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Me and Brad Pitt. If you watch Brad Pitt, every time he's on a movie, he's always eating something.
Oh yeah. And really? You're a lot like Brad. Actually.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's it. It's a trigger.
It's right in there.
So amazing.
Right in there with him.
Thanks for ruining my image of Brad Pitt. All right. Okay.
Come on, squish a little. There you go.
Please come back and listen next
Squint,
time.
Squinting the eyes.
Please come back. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, same, bless you guys. Have a great time wherever you are, on your couch, in your car.
Yeah, bless
fixing
you.
Fixing up the house, whatever you're doing.
You
bless
pray.
You. We
Brian,
love you. Brian,
for
yeah,
everybody.
Brian. Yeah, let's
go,
pray.
Go
for it, go. Brian.
I pray for all the people who don't have hair right now.
Put your hand on your heads, everybody, around the world.
John, Lord, well, God, we pray. Bless every person that's listening. God, in this crazy we questionable do. Times, God, we pray you'd be the mainstay. You'd yes, be the stagnant. Lord, we thank you for what you've done in our lives. God, we pray continue moving in and through us and God, among all that are listening, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
May
thanks.
You experience the love of God and
give it away.
Amen. All right. See you guys.
Right. Thanks.
Bye.